So, good evening, everybody.
Good evening.
So, again, coming back from a few series of quizzes, we have again come back to just our question answer sessions. Four theory questions of which are going to get answers. And today we have chosen deficiency diseases of nervous system. I've chosen topics. The phrases of which are slightly, you know, odd, something like nutrition, spinocerebellar ataxia, they have appeared periodically in our exams. It will also be useful for you to, remember them in relation to clinical case scenarios, because some of the subjects that will be discussed also are close differentials of your cases. With that, I think I will begin the session. And our first lecture is on pellagra by Dr. Kaushik Rana. And I hand over the session to Dr. Kaushik. Kaushik, please.
Okay, sir.
Thank you, sir.
Just to... good evening, friends. I'm Dr. Kaushik Rana. I'm working as an assistant professor at SBKS Medical College at Vadodara. Today I'm discussing causes and neurological manifestation of pellagra. Pellagra means rough skin. It is first described by Spanish doctor Don Gaspar Cassel. In 1735, it was described as a disease of 3D, that is, we classically known as diarrhea, dermatitis, and dementia. In 1937, nicotinamide deficiency was described as a cause of pellagra. A few words regarding niacin, that is vitamin B3. It is water soluble. It is available from bran, yeast, eggs, peanuts, poultry, red meat, fish, grain cereals, legume, and seeds. Regarding recommended daily allowance of niacin, in adult it is around 15 to 20 milligram per day. Woman 13 to 15 milligram per day. Children around 8 to 15 milligram per day. Infant 650 microgram. Lactating woman is 20 milligram. A few words regarding biosynthesis. Niacin is synthesized from essential amino acid tryptophan from the liver. 60 milligram of tryptophan is required to convert into 1 milligram of niacin. And during this process, vitamin B6 is required. In the body, niacin is converted into two important coenzymes, NAD and NADPH. This coenzyme is required for the oxidation reduction reaction, glycolysis, pyruvate metabolism, protein, fatty acids, and amino acid metabolism. And all these are required for synthesis of high energy phosphate bonds. And all these biochemical reactions, they are important for various cellular functions. And so the deficiency of niacin will affect various cellular functions. Regarding neuropathology, it has been found that there is neural degeneration in patient with pellagra, and it is due to chromatolysis, mainly seen in pyramidal and other neurons and glial cells. All the clinical manifestation of pellagra is due to affection of five pathways. They are tryptophan, kynuretic acid pathway, mitochondrial ATP generation abnormalities, polymerase pathway, brain-derived natriuretic factor pathways, and some genetic consequence of niacin deficiency. So all these pathways, they are responsible for clinical manifestation of pellagra. So basically, pellagra is a systemic disease. Classical triad is 3D, diarrhea, dementia, and dermatitis. And fourth D is death if left untreated. Regarding causes, I have divided into primary and secondary. Primary is when the amount of niacin or tryptophan is inadequate in the diet. They are seen mainly in corn consumers because corn lacks nicotinic acid as well as tryptophan, and underdeveloped countries. Regarding secondary causes, when the dietary there is adequate niacin in the diet, but absorption is impaired. They are seen in mainly chronic alcoholism, prolonged diarrhea, gastrointestinal disease like ulcerative colitis, liver cirrhosis, carcinoid tumor, Hartnup disease. It is a autosomal recessive disorder of tryptophan metabolism. And certain drugs, patient is on isoniazid, phenytoin, azathioprine, and antidepressant. So there are various causes of secondary causes of pellagra. Regarding clinical manifestation, skin changes. Classically described as dermatitis, initially it started as rash, which can be itchy, red, and it can be associated with some bullous or swelling. On long duration, skin becomes thickened, dry, scaly, and hyperkeratotic. Skin manifestation are bilateral and symmetrical, mainly seen over the sun exposed area like dorsum of hand, face, neck, and chest. On the neck, it is classically described as Castle's neck. These are the skin manifestation, classical pellagroid dermatitis. Scaly red over the sun exposed area. This is the classical photographs of Castle's necklace. Diarrhea is watery. If severe, it can lead to dehydration. It may be associated with other GI symptoms like abdominal discomfort, anorexia, nausea, vomiting. Regarding neurologic manifestation, classical, which is described as dementia, but in clinical practice, patient present with delirium. If chronic deficiency is there, then patient can present with as a dementia. Mainly neurological manifestations are neuropsychiatric. Psychiatric manifestations are irritable, schizophreniform, delusions, anxiety, visual hallucination, megalomania, suicidal tendencies, and sometimes patient may associated with cognitive deficiencies like inattentiveness, memory loss, apathy. Apart from these neuropsychiatric symptoms, other neuroaxis can be involved in the form of presence of motor signs like spasticity, positive Babinski sign, myoclonus. Some patient may present with cerebellar ataxia, and some patient with altered sensorium, like it may present, progress to stupors and coma. Alcoholic patient, they have frequently coexisting other neurologic manifestation like Wernicke's encephalopathy or alcoholic cerebellar degeneration. So clinical picture may overlap with other manifestation. Regarding diagnosis, if a patient is having classical triad of diarrhea, skin dermatitis, and dementia, then diagnosis is very straightforward. But when the diarrhea and dermatological changes are often absent, so that condition, diagnosis is mainly based on clinical ground, because the blood niacin level determination is very difficult. We can measure urinary and methyl nicotinamide acid or erythrocyte NAD-NADP ratio, but these tests are usually not available. Regarding treatment, adult dose is 100 milligram every 6 hours till the symptoms resolve. For pediatric, we can use 10 to 50 milligram orally tablet. In severe case, we can use parenteral therapy. In case of marked neurological GI symptoms, dose can be 1 gram 3 times to 4 times a day. All these therapy should include supplementation of other vitamins also. Vitamins, magnesium, zinc, and other calorie-rich diet. Because all these patients, they have associated with coexisting other deficiencies of other vitamins and other nutrient. For skin lesion, emollient can be used to decrease discomfort. Now, what are the adverse effects of niacin? flushing, peptic ulcer disease, hepatotoxicity, hyperglycemia, arrhythmias, especially supraventricular tachycardia has been described with niacin. And some patient, they may develop retinal edema and toxic amblyopia. So all these adverse effects should be kept in mind while treating patient with niacin. Now, preventive measures. Food rich in tryptophan should be taken. We have to adopt a healthy food habit, avoid alcohol intake. In patient with pellagra, for secondary prevention, we have to avoid sun exposure because the rash is photosensitive. Now, few words of role of niacin in dyslipidemia. Therapeutic dose of niacin, it can reduce level of total cholesterol by 25%, LDL up to 10 to 15%, triglyceride by 20 to 50%. And it can also increase HDL by 15 to 35%. Usual dose of niacin in dyslipidemia is 1 to 6 gram daily. Initially, we have to start it with the lower dose, 100 milligram 3 times per day. So indication of niacin in dyslipidemia are concomitant hypercholesterolemia and statin intolerance, metabolic syndrome, and patient unresponsive to hypolipidemic therapy. I think this much information is sufficient for theory purpose. If anybody is interested, they can go through this reference. Thank you and best of luck.
Good. I think that was very succinct, and I think he's managed to cover everything. Let's move on to our second talk by Dr. Nandini Mitta on vitamin responsive encephalopathies. After Nandini.
Good evening all. Today I'm going to give a brief seminar about the vitamin responsive encephalopathies. So, vitamin responsive encephalopathies, I'm not able to move it.
Yes, we can hear you.
Mansi?
Not able to move the slides.
Okay.
You'll have to click on the slide once.
Yeah. I'll be covering the topic under the following headings: introduction, classification according to age, clinical features, investigations, differential diagnosis, treatment, and conclusion. So, coming to the introduction, vitamins are essential for numerous aspects of brain function, energy production, DNA, RNA synthesis and repair, methylation, and synthesis of numerous neurochemicals and signaling molecules. Deficiency of these in infancy leads to epileptic encephalopathy, which is a syndrome characterized by intractable seizures, frequent focal, multifocal, or generalized epileptiform abnormalities with age inappropriate ontogeny on EEG, developmental delay, regression, or intellectual disability. So, treatment with a specific vitamin or vitamin derivative may halt such inexorable progression to the epileptic encephalopathy and permanent damage to the brain. So, we can classify this vitamin responsive encephalopathies according to the age of onset. So those occurring in infancy, childhood, and adulthood. So those occurring in infancy include the pyridoxine dependent epilepsy, pyridoxal 5-phosphate dependent epilepsy, autoimmune folate antibody related epilepsy, biotinidase deficiency, and infantile B12 deficiency. Those occurring during childhood include folate receptor 1 mutation related epilepsy, and those occurring in adulthood, that encephalopathies which we commonly know due to the routine vitamin deficiencies, that is namely the thymine leading to Wernicke's encephalopathy, riboflavin deficiency, pellagra encephalopathy as previously described, and B12 and folate deficiencies, pantothenic acid, biotin deficiencies. But the encephalopathy can also occur due to toxicity of the vitamins, but this we are not covering today. But for mentioning, vitamin D and vitamin A intoxication can lead to encephalopathy. So going to brief about each of them. Initially, we'll discuss about the infantile vitamin responsive encephalopathies. These are the two encephalopathies which are related to the pyridoxine metabolism. So first is pyridoxine dependent epilepsy. Age of onset is 0 to 2 months. Etiology, it occurs due to antiquitin deficiency. Antiquitin is alpha aminoadipic semialdehyde dehydrogenase. This is an enzyme which is needed for the lysine catabolism pathway. So because of this antiquitin deficiency occurring due to ALDH7A1 mutation, pyridoxine dependent epilepsy occurs. It occurs in an autosomal recessive manner. Clinical features include seizures within few hours of birth evolving to status epilepticus. Because of this presentation within few hours of birth and age of onset, it is usually frequently confused with hypoxic ischemic encephalopathy and neonatal sepsis. Intrauterine seizures are seen, but not very common as the pyridoxal 5-phosphate dependent epilepsy. And semiology is very variable. They can be focal or multifocal, focal or tonic-clonic generalized or infantile spasms. Investigations include elevated CSF and urine alpha aminoadipic semialdehyde levels. This is a direct biomarker, and also elevated pipicolic acid, which is an indirect biomarker for the pyridoxine dependent epilepsy. EEG and MRI findings are non-specific. Treatment includes initial dose with the parenteral IV pyridoxine at a dose of 50 to 100 mg. Maintenance dose is with 15 to 18 mg per kg per day to a maximum of 500 mg per day. And also because this is related to the lysine catabolism, lysine restricted diet is advocated in the infant. Prognosis is variable, and early treatment leads to good prognosis. Coming to the pyridoxal 5-phosphate dependent epilepsy, it is a PLP dependent epilepsy. The age of onset is within the early neonatal period, and etiology is due to PNPO mutation. PNPO is pyridoxal phosphate oxidase enzyme, which is needed for the conversion of the pyridoxine to the pyridoxal 5-phosphate. It occurs in an autosomal recessive manner. And presentation is slightly different from the pyridoxine-dependent epilepsy. They usually present with frequent intrauterine seizures, and infants are born prematurely, and features mimic organic aciduria with hypoglycemia, lactic acidosis, and intractable seizures. Along with the seizures, there will be complex ocular, facial, and orolingual movements, and they usually do not respond to pyridoxine because of the deficiency of the oxidase enzyme. Investigations include hypoglycemia and lactic acidosis and elevated plasma glycine and threonine levels. And the treatment includes oral pyridoxal phosphate at dose of 30 to 50 mg per kg per day. This usually do not respond to pyridoxine. And high mortality is seen instead of the treatment. Next, coming to the cerebral folate deficiency syndromes, which are related to the folate metabolism. These are folinic acid responsive epilepsies. One is occurring in the infancy, one is occurring during the childhood. So during infancy, autoimmune folate antibody related epilepsy is seen. The age of onset is at 4 months. Etiology is folate antibody mediated. And clinical features, they present with psychomotor retardation, seizures, dyskinesias, cerebellar ataxia, and spastic diplegia. There will be deceleration of head growth. And some present with visual and auditory loss, and some of them present with autistic features. Investigations include low CSF methyl tetrahydrofolate levels and serum folate autoantibodies. But MRI is non-specific, only diffuse cerebral atrophy is seen. Treatment is with oral folinic acid, 0.5 to 1 mg per kg per day. Folic acid is contraindicated because it cannot be converted into methyl tetrahydrofolate. So folinic acid should be given in these patients. Prognosis is favorable if treated with less than 6 years of age. Next, coming to the entity which occurred during childhood, the age of folate receptor mutation related epilepsy, the age of onset is at 4 to 8 years. Because of this folate receptor mutation, there will be impaired transport of folate into the CNS. So it is not available for the myelination. Clinical features include intractable seizures, ataxia, developmental delay, hypotonia, milestone regression, and in late onset cases, there will be severe polyneuropathy. Investigations include low CSF methyl tetrahydrofolate levels. MRI features are a little bit specific with pronounced cerebellar atrophy. Along with that, the delayed myelination hypomyelination are seen. Treatment is the same previous cerebral folate deficiency syndromes with oral folinic acid. Next, coming to the other infantile vitamin responsive encephalopathies, namely biotinidase deficiency and infantile B12 deficiency. Biotinidase deficiency, age of onset is at 2 to 5 months. They can also present at late onset adolescence or adulthood. Etiology is biotinidase gene mutation Bitentis is an enzyme which is needed for conversion of biocytin to biotin. So because of this, biotin will not be available for the carboxylation reactions, causing multiple carboxylase deficiency. Clinical features include seizures, hypotonia, visual and auditory loss, and one is the skin manifestations are characteristics in bitentis deficiency with atopic and seborrheic dermatitis, alopecia. Rapid visual loss can also occur, and along with the spastic paraphasis, because of the presentation with the optic symptoms and pyramidal signs, confusion can occur with juvenile multiple sclerosis. So investigations include decreased serum bitentase activity, 10 to 30% is borderline, less than 10% is taken as profound deficiency. And also they will have lactic acidosis, elevated serum CSF lactate and pyruvate with the MR spectroscopy showing elevated lactate, which is similar to the other mitochondrial cytopathies, severe presentations like Lee and Nalpers, which are presenting in the infancy. Treatment is with oral biotin 5 to 20 mg per day, regardless of the age or weight. Prognosis is good if treatment is started early. Next, coming to the infantile B12 deficiency, usually age of onset is at 4 to 8 months. Most common cause is maternal vitamin B12 deficiency. So usually they present with neurodevelopmental delay, Mystone regression, microcephaly, irritability, apathy, hypotonia, hyperreflexia, and choroid movements. And seizures occurring are very rare, but they are postulated to be occurring due to homocysteine toxicity. Investigations include increased serum urine methyl malonic acid levels and also elevated homocysteine levels in infants. It is more than 6.5 is taken as a cutoff, whereas in adults will take more than 15 as a elevated level of the homocysteine. Treatment is with either a parental hydroxycobalamin or cyanocobalamin. Hydroxycobalamin is preferred to the cyanocobalamin because of the retention, more retention. Dose is 1000 microgram daily for 1 week, followed by after every weekly should be continued. Prognosis is good with early treatment, but long-term sequelae can be preventable with early treatment. Next, coming to the adult onset vitamin responsive encephalopathies. First of them is thymine. Thymine is a cofactor for a number of enzymes with mitochondrial localization, and brain, due to its heavy reliance on mitochondrial ATP production, is highly vulnerable. This deficiency is manifestations are more evident during the rapid growth periods of perinatal period and children. And in this age group, the deficiency is most commonly associated with either malnutrition or genetic defects. So these are some of the genetic mutations affecting the thymine metabolism, which have presentation with episodic encephalopathy, namely biotin thymine responsive basal ganglia disease, Amish lethal microcephaly, which is thymine metabolism dysfunction syndrome type 3, others are type 4 and type 5. All of them have common features, like they present associated with a febrile illness, they present with episodic encephalopathy, similar again causing confusion with mitochondrial cytopathies like leaky presentation. Other clinical features are seizures, external ophthalmoplegia, gait ataxia, dysphagia. Investigations include high serum and CSF lactate levels, and treatment is with high dose thymine supplementation. And in case of biotin thymine responsive basal ganglia disease, biotin supplementation is also needed in addition to the thymine. Next, coming to the adult acute presentation of thymine deficiency, that is Wernicke's encephalopathy. It is thymine deficiency related acute neuropsychiatric condition, often with alcohol abuse. Though it is seen in alcoholics, it is also seen in non-alcoholics and pediatric population also. It is characterized by ataxia, memory loss, confusion, and ocular abnormalities, ophthalmoplegia. Though this triad is characteristic of Wernicke's, it is not commonly seen, all the three features. So diagnosis should be considered in any patient with two of the following, that is nutritional deficiency, cerebellar or ocular abnormalities, or impaired mental status or confusion. So nutritional deficiency mostly seen in the setting of bariatric surgeries for obesity, and also in case of the malignancies undergoing chemotherapy patients. And then coming to the MRI characteristics, which are typical for Wernicke's, are symmetric T2 flare hyperintensities in the mammillary bodies, dorsomedial thalami, tectal plate, periaqueductal gray matter, and around the third ventricle. Treatment is, because these areas are more vulnerable to direct toxic effects of alcohol, these areas are more vulnerable. Treatment includes daily dose of 100 to 200 mg of thymine for IV for non-alcoholics, but higher doses, 500 mg up to 3 times daily, are needed for alcoholics. And the other important thing is this should be given prior to dextrose administration, because if thymine is given, in case of thymine deficiency, if dextrose is given, the pyruvate will not be converted by the aerobic glycolysis. It will be converted by anaerobic glycolysis to lactic acid, which is toxic to the cells. So this is most important. Prior to dextrose administration, it should be given. Failure to timely diagnose and administration of therapy results in death in 70% cases and permanent brain damage in 84% cases, leading to Korafkov syndrome, which is severe short-term memory loss with hallucinations and confabulation. Next, coming to riboflavin-responsive encephalopathy, this is a rare entity. The riboflavin is necessary for the coenzymes, flavin protein coenzymes, FMN and FAD, flavin mononucleotide, flavin adenine dinucleotide. And these are crucial rate-limiting factors in electron transfer pathways. So in case of late onset glutaric aciduria type 2, that is multiple acyl-CoA dehydrogenase deficiency, this entity is more responsive to riboflavin. So in that condition, high dose riboflavin 100 to 400 mg per day is given. Other conditions which are riboflavin responsive are acyl-CoA dehydrogenase 9 deficiency and ethylmalonic encephalopathy. Next, coming to pellagra encephalopathy, in the previous talk we have extensively discussed about it, but a few points. Niacin deficiency is clinically characterized by 4Ds, as we have seen. It is mainly due to malnutrition, chronic alcoholism, niacin deficient diets like Jovan. And alcoholic pellagra encephalopathy manifests with nervousness, insomnia, hallucinations, confusion, myoclonus, and ataxia. Thymine supplementation might aggravate or trigger the development of alcoholic pellagra encephalopathy. So high index of clinical suspicion should be there for pellagra encephalopathy to any alcoholic patient who present with unexplained progressive encephalopathy not responding to thymine supplementation, and also in addition ataxia and myoclonus are present. So in those people, niacin supplementation 300 mg per day orally is essential, and this can reverse this condition. Coming to vitamin B12 responsive encephalopathy, B12 is, as we know, it is needed for the myelin formation. So the deficiency is associated with widespread neurological and psychiatric manifestations. The triad is of B12 deficiency is anemia, GI, and neurological abnormalities, which can vary from partially reversible progressive leukoencephalopathy, cognitive decline, dementia, psychosis, depression, autonomic dysfunction. And diagnosis is with serum B12 levels being less than 200 picogram per ml. If the B12 levels are normal or borderline, elevated homocysteine and methylmalonic acid levels, of which the second one is more specific, then they can confirm the B12 deficiency. So treatment in adults is slightly different. So 1000 micrograms of cyanocobalamin or hydroxycobalamin daily or every other day, then followed by weekly injections up to 8 weeks, then every 2 to 4 weeks. If we are supplementing orally, they recommend high dose of cyanocobalamin, that is 200 microgram oral tablets daily until remission. Then we can give from 100 to 1000 to 2000 micrograms. Other vitamin responsive encephalopathies which are less common are pantothenic acid deficiency, because it is a substrate for coenzyme A, which is needed for acyl activation and transfer. This can also present with encephalopathy, behavioral changes, demyelination. Biotin deficiency, as we seen in a biotin dose deficiency, they can also present with depression, lethargy, hallucinations, and seizures. Vitamin B6 deficiency, because it is a necessary cofactor in folate cycle, it can also present with irritability, impaired alertness, depression, cognitive decline, dementia, and convulsions. But it is rare. So concluding, high index of suspicion with early diagnosis and treatment of particular vitamin deficiency is crucial. And timely diagnosis and treatment can prevent irreversible damage and alter the overall prognosis. So these are my references. Thank you.
So as you can see, very, very detailed presentation by Dr. Nandini. Thank you. And as you can see, the spectrum of just vitamin responsive encephalopathies is very large, and you need to cover so many aspects in the answer if it is asked, which includes right from infancy to adulthood. So I think Manasi, can I ask Manasi to share our flyer for Thursday, just to let you guys know what we are planning for Thursday. Manasi, hello, before our next lecture.
Yes, just a moment, sir.
Yes, sir. So once I display the slide, we will move on to our third lecture. which again is a mixture, I would say, of several areas. Let us first go through this thing. Yeah. So as you can see, this Thursday we have a case presentation, and the case is of Parkinsonism, and as expert we have Dr. Mohit Bhatt, and I urge everybody to take advantage of this very useful case scenario which will be discussed on Thursday. I think with that, let's move on to our third lecture. As I said, now we have nutritional spinocerebellar ataxias, and the lecture will be delivered by Dr. Revant Reddy. I hand over the session to Revant. Revant?
Hello. Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Good evening, everyone. At this outset, actually, I want to thank Fine Forum and as well as Dr. Sripad sir and his team for giving me this opportunity to deliver a talk on spinocerebellar ataxias of nutritional etiology. First of all, actually, nutritional spinocerebellar ataxia itself is some vague term. Like, we know that spinocerebellar ataxias are more of genetic or inherited kind of ataxias or something. But nutritional, when it comes to the nutritional, what is the scope of nutritional spinocerebellar ataxia? Just I will tell you, the scope is like, why we are discussing nutritional cerebellar ataxias means, because majority of the spinocerebellar ataxias, they are actually irreversible. Genetic and inherited kinds of ataxias are irreversible, and we cannot, there is no particular treatment for them. So if you consider an important differential for this, anywhere in the neurology, we will consider what are the reversible causes of any particular symptoms or syndrome. Like this, we have to consider definitely one important differential where a patient presents with a progressive pancerebellar or partial cerebellar syndromes. So we have to definitely consider nutritional spinocerebellar ataxias, one of the important differential diagnosis, because they are treatable and they are reversible. If they are recognized early and they are treated early, definitely we can reverse the symptoms. So always we have to keep in mind when we are seeing a case of progressive pancerebellar syndrome, partial cerebellar syndrome, then you have to consider nutrition as a etiology. So what actually is the scope of nutrition cerebellar ataxias? So not only the deficiencies. So previously Dr. Nandini has said about some of the nutrient deficiencies. They can also cause the spinocerebellar ataxias. So here we are covering mainly four types of things. Like, one is deficiencies. Second thing is there is a particular entity that is gluten-related ataxia. So that is due to the immune mechanisms due to dietary content. That is actually gluten-related ataxia. And toxins, everyone knows, alcohol we consider as an important toxin, and it is common presentation in any clinical scenario. And foodborne prion disease. So these are all the four, this is the scope of spinocerebellar ataxia. So now we'll move on to the important, common and important causes. So these are the causes, deficiencies. What are the deficiencies which can cause the cerebellar syndrome, spinocerebellar ataxia syndrome? One is vitamin E deficiency. Next is B12, copper, and thiamine. These are the deficiencies which can cause the spinocerebellar syndrome. Second thing is immune-mediated mechanism, I have told, gluten-related ataxia, which is a part of gluten-related disorders. Third one is alcohol, that is actually a toxin through direct action and through vitamin B1 deficiency. And the prion diseases. So here we are considering mainly new variant CJD. This is the acquired form of CJD. So these are the main things, common things which we have to go with, we are now discussing in this lecture. And another important thing is like metabolic disorders in the like infancy and childhood, which will be treated with nutritional supplements, like that prior Dr. Nandini has told about the biotinidinase deficiency and all, and Hartnup disease. These kind of things, they also can be treated with this nutritional supplementation. So coming to the deficiency diseases, first is vitamin E deficiency. So there are many causes, like these are all actually acquired causes, like intestinal resection, Crohn's disease, bowel irritation, celiac disease, blind loop syndrome, pancreatic insufficiency. But there are this one important entity is ataxia with vitamin E deficiency, which is caused by alpha tocopherol transfer protein mutation. So that we are going to discuss in detail now. So apart from that, the other causes are disorders of like pancreas or bile secretion. These also can cause, because vitamin E is a fat soluble vitamin. So all these disorders can cause vitamin E deficiency, but mainly we will move on to ataxia with vitamin E deficiency. So how you diagnose a case of AVED is, see, it is actually, it presents like a Friedreich's ataxia phenotype. So many of us know what is the phenotype of Friedreich's ataxia. So it is like ataxia, clumsiness of hands. There will be loss of proprioception. There will be areflexia. And you see Romberg sign and Babinski sign in spite of areflexia. So, but what is specific for AVED apart from Friedreich's ataxia is, you will have titubation, a decreased visual acuity, macular atrophy, retinitis pigmentosa, dystonia. These are actually unusual in Friedreich's ataxia, which will be seen in with ataxia with vitamin E deficiency. So this phenotype also, it will vary with different kinds of pathogenic gene variants at TTPA gene, that is alpha tocopherol transfer protein. So main thing is, one thing what first you have to remember in the diagnosis, it is a Friedreich's ataxia-like phenotype. Second thing is, there will be markedly reduced plasma vitamin E concentration. So in presence of, like, there will be, like, if you do lipoprotein profile, it will be normal because there will be no beta lipoproteinemia or lipo beta proteinemia. So you will have normal lipoprotein profile. Then there will be no malabsorption syndrome. So like we have seen cholestasis or pancreatic insufficiency, that will not be there. And the confirmation is by identification of biallelic TTPA pathogenic variants. So which will confirm the ataxia with vitamin E diagnosis. So you have to remember all these points. One is the phenotype is FA phenotype. There will be reduced vitamin E concentration, but in presence of like normal lipoprotein profile, and there will be no malabsorptions. And final confirmation is by TTPA pathogenic variants we have to identify in a genetic testing. What is the treatment for AVEDs? There will be lifelong high dose oral vitamin E supplementation. So this is very, very important, and we have to identify it early. And 6 months you have to check plasma vitamin E measurements. So early treatment, definitely early treatment may it only can reverse ataxia and mental deterioration. And because it is a genetic disease, definitely you have to check in the younger siblings of the proband. So this is ataxia with vitamin E deficiency. Actually, it is an inherited disease where you will have mutations at the alpha tocopherol transport protein gene. So because of that, you will have reduced vitamin E levels. And because of that, you will get the spinocerebellar ataxia, which actually mimics Friedreich's ataxia. So next, this everyone knows, like it is a very common clinical presentation in our like subacute combined degeneration. And the classical cause also everyone knows, that is a pernicious anemia. Pernicious anemia is an autoimmune disorder. The antibodies will be there against the parietal cells. So apart from pernicious anemia, what can cause B12 deficiency is hypochlorhydria, atrophic gastritis, H. pylori infection, like gastrectomy, like bariatric surgeries, intestinal bacterial overgrowth. And if you use prolonged use of H2 antagonists and proton pump inhibitors, HIV, these are some common causes of B12 deficiency. So as seen in the name itself, subacute combined degeneration. Combined is both sensory as well as pyramidal tract are affected. So when sensory is affected, you will get paresthesias in presence of areflexia and positive Romberg sign. And motor, like corticospinal tract, if it is affected, spasticity and plantar extensors. So the symptoms will be symptoms and signs are seen both in the hands and the legs. This is the common clinical presentation of the subacute combined degeneration. So what are the less common presentations in subacute combined degeneration? Previously, Dr. Nandini was telling about this encephalopathy, like there will be reduced cognitive speed, confusion, psychosis. Apart from that, other like you will have cerebellar signs and brainstem signs. Apart from that, you can see optic atrophy, vision disturbances, and chorea. So these are also the less common manifestations of subacute combined degeneration. And how do we diagnose? Like there will be elevated homocysteine and methylmalonic acid levels. And apart from that, definitely we have to measure serum B12 measurement. And the treatment actually priorly it is said, but usually like first week you give B12 injections, like 1 mg, like 1000 microgram injections for 1 week. Then next 3 weeks you give weekly, and then monthly you have to give for many years for as a treatment of SACD. Next one is B1 deficiency, like thymine deficiency. So there are many causes, but very important causes we have to remember is alcoholism, hyperemesis of pregnancy. This everyone knows actually clinically, alcoholism and hyperemesis of pregnancy. Another thing is like anorexia nervosa, starvation, dieting, acquired immunodeficiency syndromes, hemodialysis, peritoneal dialysis. These also can cause thymine deficiency. And thymine deficiency, whatever you see the ataxia, it is a combination of things. Like it is not confined to only cerebellar. It is cerebellar, neuropathic, as well as vestibular ataxia. And how do you diagnose a case of thymine deficiency? There will be low thymine levels and erythrocyte transcutolase activity, because this is a coenzyme for the transcutolase. So low erythrocyte transcutolase activity. And prior it was said like there will be symmetric signal changes in periaqueductal gray areas. So in the appropriate clinical setting, this is the diagnostic for thymine deficiency. So the treatment is like 500 mg stat IV will give and 100 mg IV TID in the first week. This is the treatment for thymine deficiency. And next, coming to the another deficiency, this is copper deficiency, actually mimics the SACD. Like it presentation is like myeloneuropathy. It is subacute combined degeneration like presentation. And common causes are like after gastric surgeries, there will be impaired absorption. And if there is excessive consumption of zinc and iron and parenteral zinc supplementation from renal dialysis and Menkes disease, Menkes disease is the inherited disorder of intestinal copper absorption. So these are the conditions which can cause copper deficiency. So like we discussed, it is a SACD-like presentation. You will have cognitive dysfunction, optic neuropathy, sensory ganglionopathy, and asymmetrical weakness, which is of lower motor neuron syndrome, and cerebellar syndrome also can occur. So lower, how do you diagnose? It is diagnosed with low serum copper, ceruloplasmin, and low urinary copper. These are the helpful investigations in diagnosing copper deficiency. Supplementation is like 2 to 6 mg per day. Like copper salt, you give 2 to 6 mg. So now we are moving on to the next deficiencies. We have seen B1, B12, copper, vitamin E. Now we are moving to the immune mechanism. So this is actually very, very important. It can come as a 10 marks question also, because gluten related ataxia, this is actually, it is a part of spectrum of the gluten related disorders. So dietary gluten, it will have autoimmune mechanism and it will produce variety of things apart from the neurological things, dermatological, intestinal. These are all the various manifestations. And now we are going to discuss only ataxia part. So it actually contributes according to few literature, it actually contributes to 15% of the all ataxias and 40% of the idiopathic sporadic ataxias. Median age of onset is 53 years. And 40% of the GRA, like gluten-related ataxia patients, have evidence of enteropathy on duodenal biopsy. And they may not have GI symptoms, but if you do biopsy, you will have evidence of enteropathy. And at least 60% of the patients show cerebellar atrophy on the MRA. The classical presentation is like gait and limb ataxia and dysarthria. This is the presentation of gluten-related ataxia. So if you encounter any patient with a like progressive cerebellar syndrome at the age of 53, definitely you have to consider gluten-related ataxia as one important differential. So who is actually a potentially gluten-related ataxia case? So how do you identify a case? There is a sporadic progressive ataxia with anti-gliadin antibodies in the serum. So you can label them as a gluten-related ataxia case, even though there are no symptoms of enteropathy or GI symptoms. So potentially gluten-related ataxia candidate. So we have seen, apart from the progressive cerebellar ataxia, so you can see myoclonus, palatal tremor, encephalopathy, myelopathy, myopathy, chorea, stiff person syndrome like clinical features. We can encounter all these kinds of things in a case of gluten-related ataxia. So, and whenever it comes to gluten-related ataxia, one thing which comes to our mind is celiac disease, because previously everything was linked to a celiac disease and the neurological manifestations in celiac disease. But now it is recognized that apart from the celiac disease, there are gluten-related ataxia patients. So celiac disease accounts, it is actually a like iceberg disease in a gluten-related disorders. So it is only one part of the gluten-related disorders. And if you see celiac disease patients, at least 10 to 22% of the celiac disease patients can present with the neurological manifestations. So how do we identify, how do we diagnose? So we have to test for anti-gliadin in the appropriate clinical setting. So we have to test for anti-gliadin and anti-transglutaminase 6 antibodies. Actually, anti-TG6 antibodies are a little bit specific for neurological cerebellar syndrome. And so what is the treatment? Like gluten-free diet, it should cause the disappearance of the antibodies in the 6 to 12 months. And symptoms, it may take more time to improve. Like antibodies can be disappeared in 6 to 12 months, but symptoms, it may take 1 to 2 years. And definitely we have to identify it early and then we have to treat it early. Then only majority of the symptoms will be reversed. That is gluten-related ataxia. Alcoholic cerebellar degeneration. This is actually a toxin. Alcoholic cerebellar degeneration is very, very common in our clinical setting. So which actually, alcohol as a, it can affect directly, like direct toxicity is one mechanism. Another mechanism is it can cause thiamine B12 deficiencies. Through nutrition deficiency also it can cause disease. So both are slated as mechanisms. So it can, one important MCQ everywhere, like alcohol, which part of the cerebellum it will cause the degeneration? It is anterior and superior parts of the cerebellar vermis, which are affected in the alcohol-related cerebellar degeneration. So it presents as a truncal and gait ataxia. It can happen over weeks, or usually some patients with mild ataxia, if they have binge drinking, it can worsen acutely. It can present in both manners. And the treatment, so definitely you have to stop it early. Like you should supplement the vitamins which usually are and B12 deficiency in alcoholic. So early recognition and abstinence and nutrition supplementation is the treatment for alcoholic cerebellar degeneration. And hyperhomocysteinemia, now it is like it is an independent risk factor. Hyperhomocysteinemia is an independent risk factor for ischemic show. Hyperhomocysteinemia usually occurs in a setting where you have a B6, B12 and folate deficiencies and high protein diet. So patients with high plasma homocysteine levels, you have higher likelihood of occlusive disease of carotid arteries, cerebral arteries and peripheral vascular, coronary beds also. So what is the treatment? Usually we give folate, B6, B12. These can reduce the serum homocysteine. So another important subsection in this presentation is new variant CJD. So what is actually special about this is the only common form of acquired CJD, because 85% of the CJD it is sporadic and remaining are genetic. This is the only CJD which is acquired. So it is acquired through ingestion of the beef contaminated with the bovine spongiform encephalopathy, or it can be transmitted through blood transfusion from an asymptomatic carrier. These are the two modes of the transmission through which CJD can be acquired. In what way this is actually different from the sporadic CJD is, usually it is actually always below 50 years, but median age of onset is around 20 years or something, younger age of onset. And the disease course, if you see sporadic CJD, usually it will be 7 to 10 months, but here a disease course will be 14 months. And what is the early syndrome like in variant CJDs? Usually they present with the neuropsychiatric manifestations, and you will have painful sensory symptoms in the body, cerebellar ataxia and chorea. So you have a younger age of onset, longer disease course, early neuropsychiatric manifestations, painful paresthesias, cerebellar ataxia and chorea. And when, if you compare with now we are discussing predominantly about the cerebellum. So if you see, cerebellar dysfunction is seen in at least 97% of the cases in variant CJD, compared to the sporadic CJD, which is common, and it will have only 40% of the cerebellar signs. But in variant CJD, you have 97% of the cases with cerebellar symptoms. And MRI, usually we see cortical hyperintensities and ribboning. But in what is prominent in new variant CJD is pulvinar sign. Like in the pulvinar nuclei in the thalami, they will be seen as hyperintensities, symmetric hyperintensities on MRI. So pulvinar sign is one important imaging finding. So, and we know that periodic spike wave complexes in CJD, usually they are absent in the early disease part in the new variant CJD. And the prion protein can be found in tonsillar biopsy, because it is a acquired prion disease. So you can see it is in the tonsillar biopsy. Treatment usually is not there for new variant CJD. Only uniform fatality is seen in all variants of the CJD. And this is a short note, these are all the metabolic disorders in the childhood. They are actually metabolic disorders, but they can be treated with alterations in the diet. Like if you have glucose transporter 1 deficiency, which can present with cerebellar syndrome, you have to treat with a ketogenic diet. And hypobeta-lipoproteinemia, that we have seen as one important cause of vitamin E deficiency. The treatment is, we'll reduce the proportion of fat in the patient's diet. And another thing is vitamin E supplementation. Hartnup disease, it was described highly, we treat with nicotinamide or tryptophan rich diet, and advise patients on a high protein diet. Biotinidase deficiency, we treat with the biotin, and pyruvate deficiency, we usually treat with thymine, carnitine, lipoic acid, and we usually advise ketogenic diet. So these are the five metabolic disorders which usually present with cerebellar syndrome, and the treatment can be modified through the diet. We can supplement the nutrients, or we can give ketogenic diet, so that we can treat these metabolic disorders and reverse the cerebellar syndrome. Investigations, prior in each setting, I have already discussed how to diagnose and all. So definitely in majority of the progressive cerebellar syndromes, first we do MRI, which will show cerebellar atrophy and degeneration. And we do levels in deficiency states, vitamin E, B12, folate, vitamin B1, homocysteine levels. You do blood levels, you measure the levels. And gluten-related ataxia case, you do intestinal biopsies, and we check for antigliadin antibodies. And in childhood, we do metabolic workup for the specific syndromes, and we have to treat them. So these are the investigations and treatment part, and it is actually covered in each, when I discussed each and every setting there, I have discussed about the treatment. So I am not going to discuss treatment separately. So differentials. So main differentials are, we know autosomal recessive, dominant, and mitochondrial ataxias. Autosomal recessive, very, very common is Friedreich's ataxia, which ataxia with vitamin E deficiency will present like that. And autosomal dominant, everyone knows spinocerebellar ataxia 1 to 31. And mitochondrial NARP, Mellas, MERS, these are also important differentials of the nutritional cerebellar ataxias. And these acquired ataxias, usually like subacute or chronic progressive, is like hypothyroidism, multiple sclerosis, paraneoplastic syndromes, and Whipple's disease, HIV, CJD. This I have already discussed. These are the important differentials. With this, actually, I will conclude my presentation. These are the references, and I will recommend all these to go through for especially gluten-related ataxia and CJD and everything. Thank you, fine sir, Sripad sir, for giving me the opportunity.
Fantastic. I think it was a very thorough lecture and it has included everything. Great. Thank you, Revan. Let's move on to our last lecture by Dr. Bhagyadan Patel, and another topic which which also needs to be thoroughly understood, and that is nutritional neuropathies. I hand over the session to Bhagyadan. Bhagyadan. You can unmute. Hello, Dr. Patel. Yeah. Dr. Patel, you shared your screen. Hello? You shared it. We are able to see you. Yeah, your voice is not that loud. Bhagyadan. There's something about you, something with your voice. Manasi?
Maybe he can try logging out and logging in again.
Okay. Shall we ask him to do that then?
Yes, I think so, sir.
Bhagyadan, have you started talking actually? In that case,
he can hear us, but we can't hear him.
Then I'll have to tell him. Okay. Bhagyadan, do you want to log out and log in again? There's something that is preventing your voice from, yeah. No, we can't hear you. Hello, maybe either you have to increase your laptop volume or you may. So then. So then log out and log in.
Dr. Bhagyadan, you could even try joining with computer audio again. Yes, you can click on the small arrow on the right side near the mic. in that small arrow, there is a test computer sound. So you can test that and then join.
Mansi, what is the hit?
Sir, I am really not able to.
Karan, Bhagyadhan has been through a couple of sessions with us and on Thursdays, and I have never had any problem. Abhi kya ho raha hai, sir? Volume.
Dr. Patel, what you could also do is that maybe you could share screen from your laptop, and you could also join the meeting from your phone, and you could talk from your phone, keeping your laptop muted.
That you can do, Bhagyadhan. Yeah. So make use of your phone for the whole thing, for the presentation. If there is any issue with your this thing, your laptop thing, audio.
Yes, and you will have to keep your laptop volume on zero.
Yeah, do that in that case. What technical problem is this, Mansi? Yeah.
We cannot figure out.
Yeah, Ashish is correctly saying he can email the presentation to you and he can talk on phone. I don't know who is trying to call. Phone pe hi hone do, nahi kya? Haan, Bhagyadhan. Haan, Bhagyadhan, bol na. Yeah, yeah. Mansi, I have the presentation now. In a second, I think it will open on my screen and then we can just begin.
Yeah, sure, sir.
Yeah. Just a minute.
Dr. Bhagyadhan.
Yes.
Request you to keep your laptop on mute.
Yeah,
if you're not going to use that device, you can maybe log out from that.
No, I have kept my laptop on mute.
Okay.
अभी इतना खोलने में क्यों टाइम ले रहा है मेरे इसमें से? ओपनिंग ना? गलती से बंद कर दिया। Yeah, Bhagyadhan, you can begin.
Good evening. So my topic is on nutritional neuropathies. I'm consultant neurologist from Brandon Now Clinic, Ahmedabad. Shall we move to next slide? See, already we have learned that vitamin deficiency, vitamin is important for functioning of various systems. So vitamin deficiency syndrome can involve multiple systems like skin, gastrointestinal, hematological, and neurological. Among neurological, cerebellar ataxia can occur, encephalopathy can occur, but we are going to focus on neuropathy in our current lecture. So there are some common risk factors for nutritional neuropathies like restricted diet, some eating disorder, malabsorption syndromes, chronic alcohol intake, homeless persons who have nobody to care, post bariatric surgery, chronic liver diseases, chronic liver diseases, old age, pregnancy, and lactating women. So these are common for most of the nutrition. So we will move ahead with vitamin B12 deficiency. Recommended daily allowance is 1.8 to 2.4 micrograms per day. As we know, the source is basically non-vegetarian food products like meat, fish, egg, dairy, dairy products. And apart from the deficiency causes, some important causes peculiar to vitamin B12 deficiency are pernicious anemia, chronic acid reduction therapy like chronic pantoprazole usage, parasitic infection by fish tapeworm, some hereditary enzyme defects, nitrous oxide toxicity, and in our scenario, basically strict vegetarian. It is very common. Pathogenesis, it is helpful for the formation of myelin sheath, and two most important chemical reaction mediated by B12 are conversion of homocysteine to methionine, and also in which is helpful in purine and pyrimidine synthesis. And also conversion of methylmalonic acid to succinyl coenzyme. These are basically two of the most important chemical reaction mediated by vitamin B12. So polyneuropathy, it is usually land dependent. Large fiber is involved. So symptoms are tingling, numbness, and sensory ataxia. It is usually axonal in nature. Predominantly sensory system is involved. Motor system is involved in late cases. Although land dependency is not a rule, in some patients, upper limb also can be involved very early in the case, which is very, very classical of vitamin B12 deficiency neuropathy. In some cases, not only the axons are involved, but dorsal root ganglions are involved, which you can cause sensory neuropathy, where patient will have depressed reflexes as compared to SSCD. If the prominently dorsal root ganglia are involved, then patient will have vitamin depressed reflexes. As we have learned that optic neuropathy can occur, optic atrophy can occur, myelopathy already spastic ataxic gait with pyramidal signs. And one important point I want to highlight is that that symptoms in the hands can be worse than legs. In case of cervical myelopathy secondary to B12 deficiency, patient will have prominently pseudoathetosis and difficulty in coordination of hands. And they may be able to walk well. So upper limb involvement very early as compared to lower limb is very, very classical of vitamin B12 associated myelopathy. So neuropsychiatric features, already we have seen that sometimes psychosis, memory change, personality change, and early delirium can occur. Hematological, we all know that megaloblastic anemia can occur, knuckle pigmentation, which is very important clue to vitamin B12 deficiency. These are clues which will help to identify whether the neuropathy is due to vitamin B12 deficiency or any other cause. Next, so diagnosis is electrophysiology, where we see symmetrical sensory axonal polyneuropathy. It may be length dependent, it may be not be length dependent. And TBL SACP may be impaired, which is again suggestive of additional posterior column involvement. B12 deficiency is only a screening test. Active vitamin B12 levels are more accurate for B12 estimation. And as we have learned that methylmalonic acid are more specific as compared to homocysteine for B12 deficiency. And MRI, of course, which is suggestive of SACD. In treatment, 1000 mcg daily for first week and then weekly for the first month, and hydroxy cobalamin, which is the natural form, and depot injection may be available. It may be sufficient, and cyanocobalamin preparations are also available, but and they are less allergic as compared to hydroxycobalamin levels. Next, so second is folic acid deficiency. The recommended daily allowance is 400 microgram per day. It is available in most food, green vegetables, and various dairy products and various pulses. Causes of deficiency are again same, almost same as vitamin B12 deficiency, but few added causes are there where patient has chronic drug intake like pyrimethamine, trimethoprim, phenytoin, methotrexate, some antibiotics, and patient with congenital MTHFR deficiency, they can predispose folic acid deficiency. And clinical feature is myeloneuropathy. They are just like B12 deficiency, but somehow this myeloneuropathy is very less common in folic acid deficiency as compared to B12 deficiency. And sometimes it can cause cognitive impairment and affective disorder. And hyperhomocysteinemia, where MTHFR deficiency is there, we know that it can lead to cerebral venous sinus thrombosis. Investigations, again, nerve conduction study will reveal that length-dependent symmetrical large fiber involvement, where patient will have tingling, numbness, and sensory ataxia. And sometimes it is usually a gradual progressive, but rapid progression has been reported in some cases. Investigation is concerned, then serum folate is not, it does not correlate with tissue stores, and RBC folate are more reliable than plasma folate. It is less affected by the short-term fluctuations. Management is oral folate should be given 1 milligram 3 times a day, followed by maintenance dose of 1 milligram per day. For severely ill patient, parenteral formulation is also available. In women, we know that 400 microgram per day is recommended. And sometimes in severe malabsorption, 20 milligram as highest doses may be given. Reduced folate, like folinic acid, they are only required where drug intake is there, where patient is on methotrexate or pyrimethamine, then folic acid will not work and folinic acid should be given. And always while treating folic acid, a coexisting B12 deficiency should be excluded. Otherwise, if we correct folic acid and do not correct B12 deficiency, then symptoms can worsen. And plasma homocysteine is elevated, which is used for monitoring response to therapy. Somehow it is noted that plasma homocysteine, they tend to fall more precisely after folate therapy rather than B12 therapy. Thymine, the recommended daily allowance is 0.9 to 1.2 milligram per day. The causes are recurrent vomiting, alcoholism, extreme dieting, patient who has marginal nutritional status and high glucose intake. Sources are enriched and fortified grain products and dairy products and green vegetables, seafood, meat and pulses are high sources, while dairy fruit and green vegetables and fruits are poor sources of thymine. As we know that thymine plays an important role in energy production, in myelin sheath formation and neurotransmitter production. Next, sir. Peripheral neuropathy, which is only peripheral neuropathy is that we usually refer to as dry form of beriberi, and it is, as compared to B12 and folic acid, it is sensory motor in nature. Distal axonal peripheral neuropathy, sometimes autonomic neuropathy may be present, and it may be severe and rapidly progressive, that it may mimic GBS. And associated, we have already discussed that Wernicke's encephalopathy and Korsakoff psychosis can occur. Systemic feature, apart from neurological involvement, cardiac involvement can occur, where patient can present with cardiac failure, which we know as wet beriberi. Associated gastrointestinal involvement like nausea, vomiting, diarrhea, abdominal pain can occur. Investigation in among biochemistry, urinary serum thymine levels we can measure. Otherwise, we can also measure erythrocyte transketolase activation assay, which is an indirect marker of thymine level. Now, conduction study, again, sensory and motor axonal neuropathy land dependent will be seen, and MRI, we have already discussed that mammillary body and third ventricle involvement, periaqueductal involvement is common in thymine deficiency. Niacin, the recommended daily allowance is 12 to 15 milligram per day, and deficiency who are basically patient on deficient diet like corn in congenital syndromes like carcinoid and Hartnup syndrome, associated B12 and B6 deficiency, frequent dialysis, they are common predisposers for niacin deficiency. And meat, fish, poultry, eggs, dairy products, whole grain cereals, they are good sources of niacin. Clinical feature, again, axonal polyneuropathy, sensory motor, slowly progressive, is usually seen in niacin deficiency. Another feature I think we have already discussed, like skin rash, gastrointestinal involvement, and sometimes rapidly progressive encephalopathy that is not responding to thymine, it can also lead to, it can also occur in niacin deficiency. There are no sensitive blood measures available for niacin, but urinary excretion of methylated niacin can be used for niacin deficiency, and oral nicotinic acid is used 50 mg 3 times a day for treating niacin deficiency who are symptomatic. Pyridoxine, the recommended daily allowance is 1.3 milligram per day. Meat, fish, eggs, soybean, nuts, dairy products, they and whole grain cereals are good sources of pyridoxine. Cause is use of vitamin B6 antagonists like isoniazid, hydralazine, or penicillamine, alcoholism, and GI disease. And again, it is it works in a coordinated manner with folate for heme synthesis, neurotransmitter synthesis, and homocysteine degradation. Clinical feature of pyridoxine deficiency in infants, we have seen that it can present with seizure disorder. Adults do not have seizure, but they can have neuropathy, which is land dependent sensory motor polyneuropathy, where small fiber, large fiber, and motor system can be involved. Associated features are hypochromic microcytic anemia, nephrolithiasis, and glossitis, stomatitis, and chelosis. Pyridoxine toxicity, it can occur where patient is on chronic multivitamin intake, and it usually directly affects dorsal root ganglia. So here the patient will have more of burning pain, paresthesia, and sensory ataxia and areflexia. Electrophysiology, it shows impaired SNAPs, and CMFs are preserved, which suggests that dorsal root ganglia involvement is prominent. Treatment, usually in pyridoxine deficiency, we give 50 mg per day vitamin, and in excess, we should stop multivitamin usage, and it will reverse pyridoxine excess. Recommended daily allowance of copper. Copper is 900 microgram per day. Copper rich foods are seafood, nuts, wheats, and grain. And deficiency, apart from gastric surgery, malabsorption syndrome, when the patient is using zinc supplements and zinc based dentures, which because zinc, it will inhibit the absorption of copper. Myeloneuropathy, which is occurring same as vitamin B12. Hematological feature are microcytic hypochromic anemia, neutropenia, and sometimes ring sideroblasts can occur. Investigation, low serum copper, low 24-hour copper excretion, and elevated zinc level are indicative of copper deficiency. Otherwise, there are various enzymes like erythrocyte superoxide dismutase and leukocyte cytochrome C oxidase, which is a better indicator of metabolically active copper stores. It can also be used if available. In management, if we see that patient is on zinc or has zinc based dentures, then that should be removed because zinc will inhibit the absorption of copper. And oral copper supplementation should be given for 8 mg per day for first week, and then it is to be given for 2 mg per day for chronic maintenance. Sometimes in severe cases, parenteral supplementation of 2 mg per day IV copper can be given. And we should avoid co-administering iron or zinc when we are giving copper for therapeutic dosage. Vitamin E, the recommended daily allowance is 15 mg per day. Vegetable oils, leafy vegetables, fruit, meats, they are good sources of vitamin E. And apart from routine causes, if patient has chronic cholestasis, as vitamin E is a fat soluble vitamin, pancreatic insufficiency, total parenteral nutrition, and some congenital cause, we have already discussed, like cataplexy with vitamin E deficiency, hypobeta-lipoproteinemia, and beta-lipoproteinemia, which will precipitate vitamin E deficiency. Clinical feature, the deficiency feature will take decades because it is a fat soluble vitamin and body may have stores which can last for many years. And clinical features, as discussed, it will resemble Friedreich's ataxia. Patient will have spinocerebellar degeneration and associated patients have sensory axonal polyneuropathy. Investigation, low serum vitamin E levels are seen, and sometimes the associated lipoprotein level are low, and serum cholesterol and triglyceride are markedly reduced in cases of vitamin E deficiency. In management, in ataxia with vitamin E deficiency, 600 international units should be given 2 times a day. If patient has fat malabsorption, then intramuscular dosage as high as 10 mg per kg to 100 mg per kg should be given. I think, thank you. So I have tried to cover various vitamin deficiency syndromes apart from the neuropathy.
Absolutely. I think another fairly, vast lecture, vast spectrum you have to cover to be able to complete this answer. It's not just limited to, the common vitamins, but you should also include minerals, elements, like you shouldn't forget copper. And then in the etiologies, you shouldn't forget, say, for example, in folate, when patients are on methotrexate and pyridoxine, again, certain drugs themselves can produce deficiency. So absolutely, I think we've finished all our lectures. Sorry for a little technical hitch with Dr. Patel, but we
still... So you can stop sharing the screen.
Yeah, I'll stop sharing my screen. Yeah.
Then all of you will be shown larger.
Yeah. So quickly, we take a few questions that are remaining. A lot of them, we, the panelists and the speakers and myself, we've answered. Excessive use of diuretics can lead to thiamine deficiency, that is wet beriberi. Yes, Bhagyadan, you just spoke on this thing. Excessive diuretics. Yeah.
So Dr. Bhagyadhan Patel is not in the meeting.
Sorry. So let's take this. That is kindly comment. Yeah, so I think it is the use of diuretics that would cause deficiency. I don't know exactly what the person wants. I will try and figure it out. How to differentiate GBS versus beriberi clinically? Okay. So in the first place, I would like to say neuropathy is not common in adults. It's more common in younger age groups. And second, it's an subacute axonal neuropathy in particular settings without any other preceding infection. I don't think it will have albuminocytological dissociation. It will be length dependent on electrophysiology, unlike GBS, which may not be length dependent. The sural snaps will be affected, unlike GBS, where many times they are spared. So those points that come to my mind. Anybody else wants to contribute? Nandini, Kaushik, Evan, these points that came to my mind, differentiating GBS, it from GBS. The beriberi neuropathy.
Beriberi is axonal. So that is the main difference.
Absolutely.
Proximal. GBS will be more proximal weakness with the areflexia will be there. Beriberi mostly of the sensory with painful neuropathy is more common.
Absolutely. Absolutely. Which anti-tubercular drugs lead to ataxia? How to manage? I think amongst the drugs, none of the drugs directly are toxic to the peripheral nerves. Ethambutol rarely is directly toxic. Again, will not produce an ataxic neuropathy. It's a small fiber neuropathy. And it is only, even the pyridoxin deficiency is predominantly a small fiber neuropathy, correct? I don't think anti-tubercular drugs by themselves, if at all, when we used to use more of streptomycin, would cause ataxia, but that's not a neuropathy, that is a vestibular toxicity caused by streptomycin, correct? Yes, yeah, so how quick is dementia in pellagra? Dr. Rana?
I think the half-life of niacin is around 25 to 30 minutes. It requires around 5 times of the half-life to eliminate from the body. So initially, in initial stage, there is some mild symptoms which may not be picked up. And then if the deficiency is prolonged for, let's say, 10-15 days, then patient may develop symptoms of dementia. So at least it requires around 10 to 15 days to develop all these symptoms.
Absolutely. So about CJD, new variant versus other variants, H&M, comments please. I think we will have another lecture series on CJD itself. Here, to all my attendees, CJD was brought in just briefly to complete the list of differentials of ataxias, nutritional ataxias, where CJD, new variant CJD through ingestion of beef can cause this particular ataxia. We will have another session on CJD and we will discuss that in detail. How to differentiate INH induced from B6. Okay, now INH induced is pyridoxin deficiency, small fiber versus, and it's a neuropathy versus B6 toxicity causes a neuronopathy. The dorsal root ganglia of the large fibers, so it's a sensory ataxia and non-length dependent. So that's the answer to that question. Which copper salts are available? That's a good question. I'm not aware. Anybody else is aware? Otherwise, we will send on WhatsApp. How do you replace the copper? The question appeared in my mind as well. Yeah. And how quickly it resolves with copper treatment? I think it takes weeks, because ultimately the pathway goes through the same pathway of homocysteine methionine, where copper is. So it takes weeks to manage. But is anybody aware of any tablet that is available as copper?
Dosage is some 50 to 100 mg per day, sir, but tablet, I am not
tablet. Zinc I know is available as a tablet.
Yes, zinc is available.
Yeah, but copper, I will look at this personally, and I will send it on our WhatsApp groups. Is live YouTube session? I suppose it is, Mansi. Live YouTube was available, wasn't it? Hello? Postpartum woman with only small fiber neuropathy with imaging normal and metabolic workup. Postpartum woman, small fiber neuropathy, imaging normal. Okay. If imaging is normal, see again with beriberi thiamine deficiency, anytime during around the pregnancy, it is usually the Wernicke's encephalopathy that is a commoner finding than beriberi. So I would consider more of B12 folate, or not even B12 folate, small fiber. So I would consider nutritional cause of small fiber such as B6, riboflavin and others rather than B12. Correct, guys?
Yes, yes.
Yeah.
Multifactorial.
Beg your pardon?
Pretty nutritional.
Yeah. INH, and the last question is INH induced dentate nucleus toxicity. Oh, God. Okay, Revan.
Yeah.
INH induced dentate nucleus toxicity.
No, sir.
I don't know dentate specifically. We've seen dentate depositions in this calcium hyper, this FAST syndrome, and many metabolic disorders. But I'm not aware of this. We'll have to look up these two things, the copper tablet and the dentate toxicity, INH. So I think that's it. We have managed to cover all the questions, just except a couple of them. And anything my speakers want to add to the audience? I think you covered everything so exhaustively. A lot of things were covered.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, sir.
Fine Forum for inviting us.
Thank you, Manasi. It was great. Nice session today on nutrition. Great. Let's meet again after a week. Thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Bye. Okay, sir. Bye, sir. Good night.
Okay,
night, thank you, everyone. Bye, Shripad, sir.
Thank you, Ashish.
Bye, sir.